Our guest spot for this unit is Professor John Rundle. He's Distinguished Professor of Physics and Geology at University of California, Davis. He's also an external professor at the Santa Fe Institute, and he works on developing methods for earthquake forecasting and risk management using dynamical systems and other complex systems methods, and extending those methods to other natural phenomena, such as economic crises. So welcome, John.
Thank you.
Our class is currently covering fractals. We haven't talked about power laws yet, but we've talked about fractal dimension, and we've looked at some famous fractals. What would you say is the relevance of fractals in your own research?
Okay, so earthquake faults, earthquakes occur on earthquake faults. And earthquake faults are irregular objects, and if you look at them geologically in the crust, you have faults of all scales, all sizes. And the individual faults themselves, people have looked at the sort of fault trace, if you will, and found that they seem to have various fractal characteristics geometrically. Hmm. In addition to the geometrical object that a fault is, earthquake fault is, the statistics are also fractal in a sense, in that they have power laws. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the number of small earthquakes as a function of their what's called the seismic moment, which is the measure of the energy put out by the fault, that turns out to be a power law, and it reflects the fractal characteristics of the underlying fault structure.
Okay.
So one way in which fractals enter into what we do.
Okay. We in the class, we looked at a little bit of fractal analysis of time series, like for stock prices, and we're wondering about how useful those kinds of analysis techniques are in giving you insight into what's going on, say, in earthquake time series.
There's been a lot of recent work by people like Gene Stanley and Didier Sernet and some others on the details of the analogy or metaphor, if you will, between earthquakes and financial crashes. In fact, it's kind of interesting. There have been a number of recent books in the financial literature that talk about crashes as earthquake-like events.
Mm-hmm.
And the crashes often have what people refer to as aftershock-like events. So turns out the statistics are very similar. If you look at the tails of the, if you look at price changes, daily price changes, and you look at in the financial markets, and you look at the number of price changes as a function of their size, and you restrict yourself only to the biggest price changes, it turns out that those statistics look very, very similar, if not identical, to the statistics of large earthquakes. So the tails of the distributions seem to be very similar.
Huh.
And there is the tendency to want to identify large crashes with earthquake-like events.
So I've read that there's some controversy about applying statistics like fractal dimension and related fractal characteristics to things like stock prices and other phenomena. Do you think that those are valid methods of analysis?
I do, because we've actually looked at these things in a variety of different ways through a variety of different sort of mathematical lenses, and we've actually concluded that there is useful physics involved in this analogy. A lot of what I'm doing recently has not so far been published because we've been looking at modeling real financial systems with these ideas, and I'm consulting with some, at the moment, with some hedge fund guys to actually produce algorithms that are useful in trading. And it turns out so far these algorithms are really quite useful.
In terms of earthquake forecasting, what's the state of the art?
So in terms of earthquake forecasting, the basic idea is this. We look at the Gutenberg-Richter magnitude frequency relation. I didn't say those words before, but that's essentially what I was talking about when I said number of small earthquakes is large relative to the number of big earthquakes.
Right.
So it's power law. You can understand it this way. For every 1,000 magnitude 3 earthquakes, there's approximately 1 magnitude 6 earthquake. For every magnitude 4 earthquake, there's roughly 10 magnitude 3s, 100 magnitude 2s, and so forth. So you can use this relationship in the following way. if you look in a region where you've recently had, let's say, a magnitude 6 earthquake, and you just start counting magnitude 3s, then after you've counted another 1,000 magnitude 3s, it's about time for another magnitude 6. Okay, so this is the basis of the forecast method that we have embedded into a website called openhazards.com. So you can go there and get a global forecast. It's free and open to the public anywhere in the world based upon this idea.
Okay. And has it been, how successful has it been at forecasting?
It's, well, we can test the forecasts with the standard tests for forecasting, which are Brier skill scores, reliability attributes tests, receiver operating characteristic tests. All of these tests are used for forecasting, for weather forecasts as well as financial forecasts, and you can actually construct forecasts that do pretty well. Now, that being said, we do deal with probability. One of the interesting things that we've recently seen is if you look in the Japan region, so if you look at all of Japan, region right around Japan, that was, as people know, on March 11, 2011, there was a magnitude 9 earthquake there, which killed 20,000 people with a tsunami. Turns out that since that magnitude 9 earthquake, there have been about 1,000 magnitude 5s. So in just the last 2 years, there have been 1,000 magnitude 5s. Now, this relationship that I told you about earlier would seem to imply that for every 1,000 5s, there's 100 6s, 10 7s, and 1 magnitude 8 is due. So this would seem to imply that Japan right now is at risk for a major earthquake of magnitude 8 or larger in the relatively near future, in the next year or two. Okay, so this is actually, we've actually put this out in a blog on our website, notified as many people as I can think of about this possibility, and we'll see what happens. This relationship, this Gutenberg-Richter magnitude frequency relation, this power law statistic, has indeed been seen to be true in every region of the Earth that people have looked, and for all time. So it seems to be a fairly robust statistic.
But you can't really predict the when the earthquake is going to happen to the within a year or something, can you?
Not at the present time. We can only say that the conditions are in place for such a major earthquake in the relatively near future.
Okay. Do you think the same kinds of methods will apply to predicting crashes in financial markets?
Very good question. Don't know the answer to that yet, because we haven't really looked in that direction yet. But as you know, and maybe some of the people in the course know, the statistics of price changes are what are called leptokurtotic. So it's got power law tails, and it looks something like a Gaussian in the middle. So it's a little bit different than earthquake faults, but which look to be pretty much pure power law. The ideas should translate in some way, and we haven't really looked at that yet, but we will.
So what's the most exciting thing you're working on right now, exciting to you?
Right now we're still working on the earthquake forecasting. We're also working on numerical simulations of massive fault models, earthquake fault models. These are models in which they're rather like climate models. So we build systems in the computer that have many faults and subfaults and pieces of faults, let them interact, and they have friction on them. The idea is to generate synthetic time histories of millions of earthquakes and then study the statistics of those.
Great. And my very last question is, we have a lot of people in this course in different fields, and some of them are interested in getting into complex systems but are daunted by the number of different areas that one needs to know. So can you say a little bit about your advice to students who are interested in getting into the field of complex systems?
Advice to students getting into complex systems. Well, the thing I would say, two things, several things. One is you need to have a pretty good computational background.
Mm-hmm.
You need to have some knowledge of mathematics, but not an extraordinarily high level of knowledge. You need to know calculus. You definitely need to know something about probability and statistics. And you need to have an open mind. You need to consider, you know, lots of different ideas. And the fact that systems which appear to be quite different may, in fact, in some underlying way, be very similar. That is a very big leap of imagination for some people and some professionals who have devoted their lives to a particular field, but it's one that you need to be able, a leap that you need to be able to make in order to make any progress in this field.
Great. All right. Well, thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks.